Hey there, friends. Dave Paulides. And it's August 5th, 2023. Been a rough day. Probably the roughest day since Ben took his life. This isn't about me. It's about this man, Scott Carpenter. Scott was a work associate of mine. He passed away last night, 59 years old. He lived in Maryville, Tennessee. Absolutely. Bar none, one of the nicest men you'll ever meet. Highly religious. And he had two kids, Miranda and Travis. And Travis had two kids. And Scott loved his grandkids like you would not believe. And this is Scott and Maddox in a birthday photo. He looks so happy. A little history behind Scott. He served in the U.S. Air Force in the 1980s. Did his time for our country. He had a top secret clearance for the U.S. Air Force. There's an Air Force photo of Scott. Great pick. Thank you, Travis, for sending that. He was born in the area of Knoxville, in a small town called Halls, H-A-L-L-S. From his parents, he learned to love the outdoors. In later years, he had enough money to get a small boat to go bass fishing. Love that. And then every year he tried to get his son together and they'd go out hunting together. He was a single man. He had a girlfriend. They were building a relationship together. And they were out hiking about a month ago. And she fell in a creek and broke her wrist. And Scott just doted all over her, make sure he fixed a brace so she could get out of the wilderness they were in. And that's the kind of guy Scott was. He cared about people. First met Scott about 12 years ago through a phone call. And he invited me to Maryville, right at the base of the Great Smoky Mountains. And we spent a week in the woods. We'd come out every day and we'd hike different areas. After just a couple days, I knew this guy was special. Some other pictures from Travis, his dad in the woods, bass fishing. Well, I knew the woods pretty good. And just being around Scott, I knew he was super comfortable in them. And it wasn't too long after we spent a week together, started working on projects together, I said, Scott, come along, join our team. I want you part of us. And Scott did. Joined North America Bigfoot Search. And he started to attend conferences and give speeches on his work. His research was predominantly to the Great Smoky Mountains area, Great Smoky Mountain National Park. He got interested in Bigfoot when he was really young, and he saw a Bigfoot peering around a tree at him. He knew it wasn't a bear, but he wasn't quite sure what it was. And that's what really started him to look into it. When we started to really develop synergy in our work, we started to talk about some innovative ways to collect evidence. Scott was smart. He realized very quickly that using trail cams was going to get us nothing. And so we started to think. And we needed some DNA evidence. And so we talked together every night for a week. We came up with a way, a non-technological way, because we figured out that Bigfoot is going to figure the technology out. So we just put packing tape, so the sticky side was out, up on the side of a tree, and up near the fork of the tree, high up, we put pancakes, bacon grease, bacon, and in his research area, we started to get Bigfoot hair. And that was a big pump in the arm to the Bigfoot DNA project of Dr. Ketchum. So not too long after that, I went back out to Tennessee, and we were coming out of an area, and we just stopped on a ridge and we're talking. And Scott always had his camera going, usually behind him. And now when we're talking, he's just looking at the cameras, looking at the ground, I think. And all of a sudden, maybe not 200 feet from us, down in this really thick gully, a couple of Bigfoots start talking. And it's very kind of similar to the Sierra sounds. And Scott and I got that together. And Scott said, "Dave, that's so funny. I've been in here hundreds of times. It's never happened until you show up, and then you and me together get it. Maybe it happened that way so we could support each other, validate each other's evidence." Not too long after that, I got a call from Les Stroud, Sierra Man, Survivor Man. And he said, "Hey Dave, I'm doing a Bigfoot series and I need some help at some certain locations. Can you help me? I need help at A, B, C, and D. I need a location fixer for that." Well, I called up Scott and I said, "Hey, you want to work with me and Survivor Man and do a Bigfoot special with him?" And Scott was the contact for Great Smoky Mountains. So all of the work on that series at that location was really Scott. Just before we filmed with Survivor Man, Scott and I were up in the mountains doing some work, and we always carried bear spray with us because sooner or later you're going to run across a bear in Tennessee. And we're putting our stuff in the car and we're just about to get in, and who knows how or why, but the bear canister went off with us in the car. Thank goodness we weren't moving. We jumped out of the car. It got Scott worse. And we were just pouring water, our bottles of water over his face, trying to get the garbage off of him so he could see. And that was quite a funny story, actually. We laughed about that for a long time. And then another time, we're really deep in the woods. And every time I went out there, he'd give me one of his guns, so I didn't have to pack one of my guns and get cleared for DHS to get it across. So I get there, and we're both carrying guns, and all of a sudden, we're walking through this marshy, thick area. Scott draws his gun and goes, "Back, back." And I'm thinking, "Bear? What is it?" I'm looking, I don't see a bear or nothing, and he's looking at the ground. And it was a huge copperhead. We didn't shoot it. We were able to get away from it. We backed our way out. Hilarious at times. Then I had a friend named Dave Bacara. And Dave owns a Bigfoot museum in Georgia. Bacara, B-A-K-A-R-A. And at different times, Dave invited myself and Scott out to do presentations at his location. Dave Bacara and his wife Miranda, two of the nicest people you ever want to meet. And Scott got a chance to go out there and talk and meet him. And then he was out there, Scott was out there one time, and I happened to be out there speaking, and we got together at Bacara's shop, and we took this picture. And Scott just would do that. He'd, hey, you're going to be in town? Okay, let me get out there and meet you. We'll have lunch or something. So, thankfully, I got to spend time with him. Now, Scott started to ask me a lot of questions about writing books. And I said, hey, there's no mystery to it. Well, Scott had a bachelor's degree. He's well-educated. And he goes, I think I'm going to give it a shot. I said, yeah, do it. You have a lot of great info. You could really do a lot. And he started off with a couple of books, one called The Bigfoot Journal. Then he wrote one called Dog Man and Monsters Are Real. Then he wrote, for some reason, as he got more popular, the books really started to take off. One called The Nephilim Among Us. And the biggest seller of all time for him was The Truth Denied. And that was about the DNA project. And he worked with Dr. Ketchum to get the emails that went back and forth between Dr. Ketchum and the journal, showing how the journal manipulated her work and how it was a completely an unfair situation. And he showed the facts of the case. All of his books are outstanding. Let me just say, the book, I sold them last year. That's how good they are. Well, luckily, there were other times we got together. 2 years ago, I was doing the Bigfoot conference in Gatlinburg. Scott was going through a divorce, and I said, just come and meet Angie and I, hang out with us, and just get your head out of it. And he did. He hung out with us, had a good time, was around people. Tons of people came up to him and go, hey, you're Scott Carpenter. Because he had spoke at that conference the year earlier. And then I heard from Travis that Scott really said that I supported him during those hard times. But buddy, what he did for me, I could never repay. Scott was a film guy. He took a lot of great film of the outdoors. It was one of the reasons that Ben and I always talked about film. And probably one of the reasons why Ben got on the track of doing a film with me. But when Ben took his life, one of a handful of my friends that showed care and true friendship was Scott. He was there every day. He cared. He understood. We talked about religion. Our bond got a lot closer. Ago, we planned, Scott and I planned for a long time. To spend a week together back in the woods, something we haven't done in a long time. So, I flew to Knoxville, and we spent a week, just 3 weeks ago, in the woods, doing all kinds of stuff that we used to do. It was a blessing from God that I got that time with him. We talked about stuff. We talked about how there seems to be a group out there in that Bigfoot world that likes to call people names, berate us for our beliefs that Bigfoot's not an ape or a gorilla. This guy didn't care. He didn't care. He said, "Dave, those people are lost. The best they can do is to just call us names, swear at us, call us fools." And I said, "Hey, Scott, did you know I was at a conference and a very famous speaker said he's been doing Bigfoot research for 25 years and he's never heard of anything as paranormal associated with Bigfoot?" Scott's just started laughing. They're lost. Scott did a TV show a couple years ago. And before he did the show, we talked. And I warned him, I said, "Hey," because he asked, he goes, "Why aren't you doing more shows?" I said, "I turned them all down." And he says, "Why is that?" I said, "I learned a long time ago that they will take the footage of you and manipulate it into anything they want. Meaning, they want the message to be A and you're telling a message B, they'll just edit it around so you're not saying it. And if they can't do that, they'll make it look bad." And I said, "If I can't have a say in the last edit, forget it. I don't need the coverage anymore. That's okay." So we talked and talked, and he did the show. And some so-called expert came out and said that what he presented wasn't credible, wasn't truthful. A total lie. And I knew it. Scott knew it. Scott, you'll be in my heart forever. You're a great researcher. Your kids will love you forever. This is how I will always remember you, Scott. A smile on your face, a friendly hello, and a credible researcher. I know you have a front seat in heaven, Scott. You know all the secrets now. God bless you.